गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी यशोदनंदन व्रज जन रंजन यशोदनंदन व्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरावन चारी यमुना तीरावन चारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी गोपी जन वल्लभ गिरिवर धारी यशोदनंदन व्रज जन रंजन यमुना तीरावन चारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे जय राधा गोपीनाथ राधा गोपीनाथ राधे जय गौर निताय जय गौर निताय गौर निताय जय गौर निताय जय श्री गोपाल श्री गोपाल जय श्री गोपाल जय जय प्रभुपाद 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 जय जय गुरुदेव 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 जय विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिवेदाचार्य स्तोत्र शिष्य मिस डिवाइन ग्रेस एसी भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी श्रील प्रभुपाद की जय जय विष्णुपाद परमहंस परिवेदाचार्य स्तोत्र श्री श्रीमद डिवाइन ग्रेस भक्ति सिद्धांत सरस्वती ठाकुर शिल प्रभुपाद की जय अनंत कोटि वैष्णव वृंद की जय नामाचार्य श्री हरिदास ठाकुर की जय प्रेम से कहो श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवास श्री गौर भक्त वृंद की जय श्री All glories to assembled devotees, all glories to assembled devotees, all glories to assembled devotees, all glories to Sri Guru and Sri Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskrityam. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam. Tato Jaya Mudirae. Nashta Praishu Bhadreshu. Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya. Bhagavati Uttama Shloke. Bhakti Bhavati Naishtaki. So we are reading today from Canto 1, Chapter 2, chapter entitled Divinity and Divine Service, text 13, 1-3. Please repeat after me. Ata pumbhi dvija shreshta varnashram vibhagasha Svanushtitasya dharmasya samsidir haritoshanam. Ata pumbhi dvija shreshta varnashram vibhagasha svanutitasya dharmasya samsidir haritoshanam. Ata pumbhi dvija shreshta Varnashram Vibhagasha Svanushtitasya Dharmasya Samsidir Haritoshanam. So, Pumbhi, by the human being, Dvija Shreshta, O best among the twice born, Varna Ashram, the institution of four castes and four orders of life, Vibhagasha, by the division of Svanushtitasya, of one's own prescribed duties, Dharmasya, occupation, Samsiddhi, the highest perfection, Hari, the personality of Godhead, Toshanam, pleasing. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Translation. O best among the twice born, it is therefore concluded that the highest perfection one can achieve by discharging the duties prescribed for one's own occupation, according to caste divisions and orders of life, is to please the personality of Godhead. Purport. Human society all over the world is divided into four castes and four orders of life. The four castes are the intelligent caste, the martial caste, the productive caste, and the laborer caste. These castes are classified in terms of one's work and qualification, and not by birth. Then again, there are four orders of life, namely the student life, the householder's life, the retired, and the devotional life. In the best interest of human society, there must be such divisions of life, otherwise no social institution can grow in a healthy state. And in each and every one of the above mentioned divisions of life, the aim must be to please the supreme authority of the personality of Godhead. This is very unusual that in this line has been put in italics. You rarely see this in the purport. So obviously to highlight the importance, Prabhupada has put this in italics. So I'll just read that previous sentence. And in each and every one of the above mentioned divisions of life, the italic starts now. The aim must be to please the supreme authority of the personality of Godhead. This institutional function of human society is known as the system of Varnashram Dharma, which is quite natural for the civilized life. The Varnashram institution is constructed to enable one to realize the absolute truth. It is not for artificial domination of one division over another. When the aim of life, that is realization of the absolute truth, is missed by too much attachment for indriya priti or sense gratification, as already discussed herein before, the institution of the Varnashram is utilized by selfish men to pose an artificial predominance over the weaker section. In the Kali Yuga, or in the age of quarrel, the artificial predominance is already current, but the saner section of the people know it well that the divisions of castes and orders of life are meant for smooth social intercourse and high-thinking self-realization and not for any other purpose. Herein the statement of Bhagavatam is that the highest aim of life or the highest perfection of the institution of the Varnashram Dharma is to cooperate jointly for the satisfaction of the Supreme Lord. This is also confirmed in the Bhagavad Gita 4.13. Om Agyan Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yuta Padakamalam Shri Guru Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakanvitamscha Hey Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dinabandhu Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Rishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanchakalpa Tarubhyascha Kripa Sindhu Bhayevacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhaktavrinda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram Hare Ram 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So this is one of the most important verses of the Srimad Bhagavatam, often quoted. In fact, Prabhupada spoke on this verse
many times, various parts of the world. And of course, we have heard this from the various gurus also. Because one of the most important, in fact, Srila Prabhupada encapsulates, if you want to have a definition of what paraphrasing means, this is really it. In just maybe 10, 15 lines, Prabhupada gives the whole world, how the world should work, how we individually should work, and what is the purpose of life. So I'll just repeat one or two important lines. In the purport, he says that the entire Krishna conscious lifestyle is for anyone to live, because we have the four orders and the four castes. They're classified in terms of one's work and qualification, not by birth. So these castes and qualifications, these castes and orders are natural. So wherever you are born, whichever part of the world, you will have certain attributes, etc., and you are going to be there may be no formal classification, but it is just the attributes will put you in certain categories, and it is not by birth. And he says now, this classification are necessary in the best interest of human society. Otherwise, no social institution can grow in a healthy state. Now, this is only the small part, not the most important. But in each and every one of the above mentioned divisions of life, the aim must be to please the supreme authority or the personality of Godhead. Called the Varnashram Institution for Civilized Life, it is constructed to enable one to realize the absolute truth. That means the four orders and the four ashrams are natural, they're created. Wherever we are born, whatever gender, background, etc., we will find that. But that is incidental. That is something which we have to go through life in our own best abilities. But the most important thing is, the key part is, the aim must be to please the supreme authority or the personality of Godhead. So, backgrounds are different, cultures are different, strengths, weaknesses, liabilities, assets, everyone has cultural backgrounds, environmental backgrounds, so difficult. Also, everyone has every struggle. All 7.8 billion people in this world would have their own customized lifestyle or life issues. Each one is tends to get occupied within their own world. But the key, as Prabhupada says, is the highest aim is to cooperate jointly for the satisfaction of the Supreme Lord. So he gives, right from the beginning, one of the earliest examples which really attracted me, simplest examples, was about the body. How the body is, there are so many parts of the body, and the brain, people think the intelligence is the most important thing, so therefore the brain is the most important. But the brain cannot do without the cooperation from, say, the hands or the legs. If the legs don't move, then where does the brain has severe limitations. So this is an example to show that everyone has their space in life, because it is, as I said, it is incidental. Someone, because of karma, because of mercy, may have been destined to rule a certain country, or he may be having an important position. And someone may be just an ordinary, so-called ordinary person going on in life. This is incidental. The important aspect is what we, in whatever capacity we are put in, what do we do to go to the real aim? And especially if we have been given the causeless mercy, as we can see, it is causeless, that how somehow accidentally we have just, so-called accidentally, we have kind of stumbled into connection with an association of devotees, and we come in presence of Radha Gopinath. It's like, someone just, as children you play, they put a bandage on your eyes in a game, and then, they want to give a pleasant surprise, and suddenly the eyes open, and then you see a whole, box of goodies or some thing. So it's almost like that because the child doesn't know, and who suddenly someone takes and then brings the room and then says, oh, I didn't know this. But it is really something like that we have almost, because of different circumstances, have come. So even, so especially so, now that we have got this opportunity, it becomes even more important. So therefore, pleasing the Lord means everyone has something or the other, some ability, because ability doesn't have to be world class or, you know, visible, noticeable. Whatever we have, whatever we do, whether it is an art or education or, you know, physical strengths, certain bent of mind, a certain characteristic of, you know, someone is very soft-hearted. So there may be several things, whichever attributes we have, we can always bring this forward. And we have so many examples, because by now for us, we are in 2021, and ISKCON was established in 1965. And right from the beginning, those 12 years that Srila Prabhupada was there, and even after Prabhupada has left, these are examples in front of us to see how, what has been achieved. And initially it was mainly establishing temples, distributing books. But then as the Varnashram system was getting, and the congregational development involving families came into being, more and more we have seen that all kinds of categories, even running a restaurant is an activity, can be a business, but it is employing devotees, but also it is serving prasadam. Then we have, you know, distributing prasadam to the needy, the hospital. This is in our congregation, but all over the world there are farm communities, there are temples, there are so many, all activity, even businesses that are being run, are actually run for the, so many devotees who, it is a matter of the intention. So many devotees make Krishna their partner, directly or indirectly, and whatever they are doing, the motivation is that what can they do to help the Vaishnavas, what can they do in whatever capacity. So basically it's the activity and the intention which is most important. The activity will be dependent on what we are, what our circumstances are, but the intention is the critical need, which is really where our intelligence dominates the mind, and the intelligence needs to be purified. And that's why we follow the process of Krishna consciousness, certain rules, regulations, etc. There is a purpose behind it. The cleansing process, as we hear, the purification process is necessary. So while we may be lurching left and right, we may be making mistakes here and there, life goes on. But the question is, are we committed to the struggle? And are we learning from it? Are we taking help? And are we associating? That's why association becomes the most important thing. Association is so critical because we observe. We see other people's examples. See, association is not only that we say, like, this is association when we are hearing about Krishna Katha, which is direct. But then there are many, many other benefits or associations that happen, because when we are moving around, the influence that is there, there are more subtle influences than direct influences. So when we associate with people, slowly over time, we do observe people's lifestyles, how they are facing challenges or whatever, how they are managing. And then our thinking gets preoccupied that way. So therefore, this becomes important. So the purpose of life would be to see that whatever activity we do, it is somehow linked to pleasing the Lord. And there's a process of doing it. Pleasing the Vaishnavas, pleasing the Guru is pleasing the Lord. Otherwise, it is said, Shrama eva hi kevalam. Everything else is only useless labor. So whatever, it may be glorified or it may be sanitized, it may be, you know, superficially glowing, but ultimately, if the purpose is not served, that is useless. Now, here there's a very crucial point to understand, that we differentiate generally between material and spiritual, saying that. So Prabhupada beautifully explained in one sentence, which completely clears everything, that when the material activities are enacted for spiritual purposes, then it becomes spiritual. So it is not again the activity that I say that, well, I'm working in a bank, so it is material. And when I come home and I take my bead bag or I come to the temple, it is spiritual. No, it is the consciousness that matters, and it is the intent that matters. So Prabhupada said that actually nothing is material. He simply defines material, because when we define material, say material means it has got this element, this metal, that. Prabhupada said material means forgetfulness of Krishna. That's it. very simply put in the everything. Otherwise, even this can be spiritual if it is used. Even a microphone can be spiritual. So the ultimate definition is material means forgetful of Krishna. That's all. So Krishna is the supreme. Everything is coming from Krishna. So and Krishna's energy is variety. So he gives a beautiful analogy to explain this, that just like the sun, you know, we get the heat and the light from the sun. These are the two main energies coming from the sun. When you look at the sun or when you experience the sun, you cannot separate the light and heat. It is because there are two energies coming from the sun. So similarly, the two energies which are coming from the from Krishna are the material and spiritual energy. This material energy is mind, intelligence, ego. That's the gross five, you know, earth, water, fire, air, ether. So this would constitute the material energy, and the spiritual energy is the living entity. So just like when you mix the two, when you mix any two elements, you have some reaction. And so similarly here, these two, it's a matter of the consciousness. So as long as we think that it is we are away from Krishna, then all those activities are material. As soon as we attach Krishna to it and put that in the center, then irrespective of what we do, it becomes spiritual. So another example given is that an atheist who doesn't believe in God, if he comes to the temple and he sees the deity, he will think it's just a stone or a statue. While a devotee will see it in a different light. So the same activity, same material is there, same external manifestation is there, but the consciousness completely is different. So basically, because they're coming from the same source. So any society or anyone who is devoid of Krishna's presence or this understanding that life is for pleasing the Lord ultimately and going back to Him is in darkness. So darkness means the absence of light, and light is really this consciousness, this light, this knowledge that what the purpose of life is. So therefore, once we are in darkness, then what happens is that then various adjustments take place, because ultimately every living entity is looking for happiness. And that it's by itself is natural and is nothing wrong. I mean, that is in fact natural. You can't do without it. That is what the purpose for everyone is, to seek happiness. It's only the process and the object that gives us happiness differs. So as long as we are looking from the various adjustments in life, Srimad Bhagavatam says that it will never happen. You will never have happiness, because there will always be anxiety, there will be fear. Even if you have externally, as I say, a lottery lag gayi, someone is really, you know, doing brilliantly for whatever reasons, I mean, externally we see, but we don't know what the person's mind is and what anxieties. And when typically human nature is that what we have, we want to be always anxious and worried that somebody else may either take it or somebody else may actually have more than that. And therefore, our whole attention focuses to that. So the instead of appreciating what we have got, and that appreciation can come only if we know who has given us, and what the gratitude can come only if we know what that purpose is. Whatever we have been given, whatever attribute or asset is given, if we don't know the purpose of it, then we are always going to be in anxiety. So Srimad Bhagavatam says that it will never be fulfilled, this desire to be away from Krishna and whatever adjustments we do. And then the example is given of the lady and the cage. Simple example, that there is a very beautiful cage and a very nice little bird inside the cage. But the lady is so engrossed in polishing the cage and really making it glowing, making shining. So to the extent that it forgets to feed the bird, and she forgets to feed the bird, and the bird dies. So that means, so it's similarly for us, we are only external, concerned with the externalities. We're concerned with the body or bodily designations, and we're not concerned with the soul whose link is with Krishna. So this is where the spiritual material lineup works, that where we are, the attachment to Krishna makes everything completely different. And then what happens is that if we, the darkness happens because no matter whatever efforts we make, whether in society or in economic ways or in religious also, so-called, without the understanding and acceptance of our goal, that is to please the Lord, everything will be, that so-called adjustment will be, will in fact make things worse. And we can see that today, in general, all over the world, anyone can see over the last 30, 40, 50 years, the society has become so much self-centered. You know, everything is focusing towards that. In fact, what is difference between 30, 40 years and now is that slowly this becomes actually a glorified goal. That this is what life is about, that we have to do. That's why this talk about freedom. What is the freedom? The other side of the coin, the talk of freedom is that let me do what I want, I and mine and me. So there should be no restriction. I just do what I want, to the extent of completely breaking up, breaking all links of the past. So it doesn't achieve anything. Then if you talk of regulative principles, it is considered as constraint. And when we talk of four regulative principles of freedom, it is bewildering. People cannot understand that. So actually, by continuing this pursuit of mindless and godless approach, or selfish approach, self-centered approach, only takes us into bondage, because we don't know that if we don't accept the laws of karma, then we are just creating so many lifetimes of suffering in the future. Similarly, in religion also, we may be so-called religious. There will be, it is today in Kali Yuga defined more as tokenism. You just show some tokens, some signs of it, visits to temple, or you dress up on certain festivals. So the purpose of accepting the Lord is not there. The holiday is very important, but the holy day part is missed. So it is just now the enjoyment. What is in it for me? Right? So everything becomes centered around my purpose, my need, my happiness. But the whole background, what was there in some decades ago, some centuries ago, there was a meaning to even the festivals, why they were being done, how they were done. We read in the papers, but today we see, like in Ramayana, we know what was the meaning of Diwali when Lord Ram comes back. So the mood of the Ayodhya Vasis was, it's indescribable how they were just anxious for 14 years and how happy they were. The houses were lit up, the people were in the streets, everybody was throwing flowers when the grand entry comes in. And today, we just put Ram aside, but we celebrate Diwali with having all the fun and festivities. So this is where the twist comes in. So the adjustment is only that, just make the inconvenient part out, just take God out, and then it's much easier. And then even if we accept God, but then again, my God is better than yours, my religion is better than yours. So therefore, it becomes a matter of ego, that I'm following this religion, therefore this path is most important for me and is the best, and all others will go to hell. So the superficiality, the showiness, it passes for religion, because also it may give us a satisfaction that I'm on the right path, I know what I'm doing, I'm getting happiness, and see, it is, you may even dress the deity very well. But ultimately, if the motive is for my pleasure and for what I am doing, then it is, Krishna knows best. He knows before even the thought comes in our mind. Even the economic goals also follow this, because see, the values will dictate that. So today's values would be, if it is material and if it is self-centered, then the economic wealth creation and consumerism becomes the most. Everything is marketed. Now, you see, in the last 10, 20 years ago, say for instance, Ayurveda and homeopath, all over the world. In fact, the pharmaceutical lobby is so strong all over the world that they would not even allow this to be present. In fact, in many countries, it would be seen as some hocus-focus and some voodoo kind of thing. Really, it was, while there were many individual practitioners in Germany or in the US, but they couldn't even be acknowledged. Now there is a slow acceptance and acknowledgement. But while the acknowledgement is there, it is only to see what is the how to market it for material gains. So now even the most the most successful marketing companies will take it. So at least it's good that they are taking natural products. But the idea is that how best to extract it for without giving the credit where it is due. That to say that it is natural, that means it's part of the laws of the God. Or at least if you don't, today using the word God in most circles is considered abnormal. This, they hardly talk of it. And if rarely when you find also the name in a newspaper, you'll find it with a small g. I know when I was younger, it was always considered a capital G. So these small, small things, gradually it is just an inconvenience which is being moved out. So the perfection of life is Hari Toshanam, which is to satisfy the Lord, and doesn't matter who we are. This is the most relieving, reassuring thing, that wherever we are, whoever we are, there is, because we are so brainwashed to think that superior life is this and inferior life is this. I am, because externally we can see with our eyes, which are limited, and then we make our own judgments that this person is so lucky, this person is so happy, this person has got everything. So we are judging it only by those values. But if that person has all the resources, attributes, and doesn't see it in the proper way, we have no idea what that person is going through. And why do we need to bother about it? But take the faith in the Shastras that every person is struggling. If I'm struggling and you are struggling, then it is not because of my material condition. It is because of my understanding and consciousness. So externally, irrespective of the situation, anxieties will be there, fear will be there. But to change that needs a change in consciousness. And I would also make a point that we talked about ISKCON, so many projects are there, and there were so many successful projects because there is a there has been, and not to say only ISKCON, but we know ISKCON, that's what we are saying. There may be many other also, but I want to make the point that it is not only the external part, like we saw in Prabhupada's time, 108 temples that came up. But we don't know how many hundreds of temple projects or efforts failed. Now, these so-called failures are also successes in this definition. So therefore, if we have that faith that it is the struggle and it is the intent rather than attachment to the result, that somebody may have gone to, so many people went to very difficult parts of the world where at great risk and could hardly show anything externally. Well, in some parts it just flourished. Like today maybe in India it is flourishing because there is a so-called revival of interest in spirituality and at least people are appreciating it to a much larger extent compared to some parts of the world. But it doesn't mean that in other parts there may be just two people or five people in a certain city. And or it may have been, the temple may have been closed down. But if somebody has put in, say, 10 years of effort to do that, it is, we can't even compare how, how Krishna would see it. So it is not that when we say that this temple has, say, sold 50,000 books and this temple has sold maybe 1,000 books. But we don't know the background. There may be only two devotees in a very different, difficult environment. So the point is that, again, we shouldn't be looking only by judging the successes. We should also recognize that it is equally glorious and equally successful in terms of the activity done in the right spirit. So, the simple examples that have been given is that when we water the root, the whole tree benefits. Similarly, when we please Krishna, everyone benefits. And watering the root means all branch, leaves, a trunk, everything gets benefit. We just have to go to the root, and the root is Krishna. And same in the body example also, the stomach, you supply the food to the stomach, then every part gets it. It's so beautifully designed that there is each and every, right from the toe, fingernails to the toenails to the highest part of the world, to the head, all parts of the body get the benefit. And to illustrate this, we have a story in the Mahabharata where when, Draupadi and Akshay Patra, when they were in the Pandavas were in the forest. So Duryodhan, in his wicked attempts, wanted to finish off the Pandavas. And he knew that Durvasa Muni being very easily pleased but also very easily upset, because he was a very powerful sage but also prone to be very angry. So he sent him at the very inopportune time in the forest, and just knowing that when Draupadi finishes her meal after serving the Pandavas, then there's nothing left. And Durvasa Muni went there with 60,000 of his disciples. So Krishna comes there, and when they were completely helpless, and when Durvasa Muni came and they went for a bath in the meantime, and then they were fearful that how will we please him, because we don't have anything to offer. And when Krishna comes, and then he says, fine, and then in the bottom of the pot there is just one small speck of food grain. So when Krishna just took that speck of food grain, everybody's stomachs got full, and which is illustrative of what we are saying, that when we please Krishna with whatever we have, everything is taken care of. Then Krishna is very easily pleased. You know, he says, patram pushpam phalam toyam. So whether it's a leaf or a water, because he is not a beggar. Krishna wants your love. He has everything. He's only created everything. But he wants to see how we approach him in whatever situations. So the situations may come for various reasons, and it is individualized for all of us. In those situations, how we face up, how we react, is what Krishna wants to see. So the tangible results are not important. It's really the attempt to surrender to Krishna's will. Like in Arjun's case, he was a Kshatriya, very powerful, and initially he was trained to kill, but he was refusing to do so. But only when he finally surrendered, in spite of, you know, initially his thinking was that, well, all my family, etc. are there, when he surrendered, then that was his glorification. Otherwise, it was for his own satisfaction, that he was thinking that I should not be doing it. So basically, as in Arjun's case, even our understanding of violence, non-violence, morality, immorality, that definition is in the eyes of how we please Krishna. Otherwise, we'll come to our own interpretations of what is moral and what is immoral. I mean, that way every institution you'll see, whether they're commercial or non-commercial, has a long list of code of ethics and all that. So they define it in a narrower sense, which is also fine that, okay, you know, you should be honest, you should not be doing this. But that is again, it's like Prabhupada said, is honor among thieves. So ultimately, we are thieves because we are taking away from Krishna. And then within that, we are saying how we will distribute it, how we put the laws of orderliness in the world. We create institutions, you know, maybe a World Bank or a United Nations or a Human Rights, whatever. That we'll create and they will order. But the whole purpose, the main thing is missing. So clearly, this is the missing link. And we have seen also in Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's case that, you know, he had such a dear friend who was so poor. That is also illustrative to us. Kulavicha Shridhar, his story, where, you know, he was a banana leaf seller and he hardly made a few paise a day. And within that also, because he never expected anything from the Lord, even though he was so attached to the Lord. But the Lord was so attached to him because he saw that even with that few paise, he was spending half of it to do Ganga Puja. So knowing, and he was somehow managing, and very difficult, he was in clearly subsistence level by today's standards, by any standard actually, but he was contented. So he found contentment in pleasing Ganga Mata, and because of that, Krishna was very, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very happy. So once His Holiness Radhananda Maharaj, when he was speaking about Raghunath Das Goswami's story, he gave some very nice instructions when he gave the conclusion of just when you're talking of attachment to Krishna is the goal. So he was saying that the perfection of detachment is complete attachment. And he used the story of Raghunath Das Goswami because he said that detachment is used to transform our attachment from the material objects to something attached to Krishna. So it is not like you push it away, but only that our consciousness changes, means it's a transformation. Transformation of our consciousness, and not everything else remains the same. But where do we get attached? So in Raghunath Das Goswami's case, he was a multi-billionaire by today's standards. You know, his father and uncle, they owned lakhs of acres of land, and you know, and he had so many dozens of servants. It was really, to say he was wealthy is an understatement. In spite of that, because he had such a burning desire to serve Lord Chaitanya, so he tried so many times to run away from home. Every time he was brought back, and then there were 12 guards around the clock guarding him so that he would not go away. Still, somehow, it is, he prayed and prayed, and he managed to go, and he went. And in fact, he also had such a very beautiful wife, who was not only beautiful externally, but internally also, very cooperative. So he had everything, but because he was, you know, he was an associate of the Lord, he had such a strong desire, so he left everything and he went to the, he just wanted to do seva. So, and then there's a whole story of how he almost starved when he, for 12 days, he didn't eat anything, and he went to Jagannath Puri. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was very pleased. He gave him this Govardhan Shila, which he was very attached to, and he was very, he was worshipping it for the rest of his life. So, Radhanath Swami Maharaj made this statement that a multi-billionaire gave up billions and a complete luxury for worshipping a little stone with little eyes. From a material point of view, material perspective, Shila is only, they may, as an atheist or a non-believer, would have no value. So it is inexplicable how externally everything is, you know, just the consciousness changed. So consciousness of Raghunath Das Goswami, though he was brought up in such a lavish state, but he completely changed, because he changed means he was always the same. It was not that he changed, but externally when he got the opportunity, he attached himself to Lord Chaitanya. So Radhanath Maharaj made some, on that story, he made some very nice statements. One is that if our renunciation, because this is a story of how, this is the height of, we can say, the ideal example of renunciation, which of course we cannot follow, we cannot imitate, but we should follow the guidelines and get inspired by Raghunath Das Goswami. So in that connection, Radhanath Swami Maharaj mentioned that if our renunciation makes us proud, or it makes us hard-hearted, that I have done this or I have done that, secretly finding ourselves very happy, satisfied, contented, you know, patting ourselves on the back. We may not do it externally. Externally, we may still say that, no, 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 I'm nothing. But internally, we rejoice that I'm able to do it. And, you know, somehow feeling that it is my capability that is being able to do it, then it is a major impediment to attachment to Krishna. So that attachment to Krishna would not come unless so the barometer is to see that unless our heart becomes soft, we will not be attached to Krishna. He also said that actually we have no powers to be detached from the attraction of this world. Only by the blessings of the Vaishnavas, by the mercy of the Lord, is it possible. So this is a statement we use often, you know, by saying that by your mercy, by your blessings, or by Lord's blessings, Prabhupada's blessings. It is true. But sometimes we say it, how much do we really mean it? Because actually every word is, it's like you cracked the code. You know, that's it. That is it. That these are the 10 words that by the blessings of the Vaishnavas, by the mercy of the Lord. So if you just contemplate on that, what it means is that, you know, how much gratitude we should have that because of the causeless mercy, because of devotees' prayers. Sometimes we say, devotees, please pray for me, please pray for me. I mean, even we don't ask. Devotees, so many times, they may be praying just when a genuine devotee feels sad for someone's story and someone's difficulty, and they pray for someone. Who knows what that value is? We cannot estimate the value. It is incalculable. So, knowing that, you know, we should be deeply grateful that clearly a devotee's prayers have worked, that things could be much worse for me. Much worse. It's always, and there's no situation where you cannot say it cannot be worse. So that things could be so much worse. So we only tend to think that what is the, we always look at the negative things because we only want positive things in life. But actually, when we look at the negative things and see it this way, that things could be much worse, and sometimes we do get that realization later, because when some events unfold and then we see that I was saved. But sometimes we may not see it and we just take it for granted. So then we should really take this aspect that how important it is that nothing happens without, so all our efforts can only be to please the devotees or please the Lord. That's all. Our concentration should be only that focus, that am I pleasing genuinely, not externally, I mean not necessarily to see the reflection and to kind of get the acknowledgement, and every day you ask that, are you happy, are you happy? No, that is not that. But the thing is that we can, if we are absorbed in that service, and if it is most important for us, clearly we will know whether we are on the right track or not. And in case we are confused, we can always ask. So that was one. Then Maharaj also made the point that attachment to other devotees, and he gave the example of that ordinary dog, Shivanand Sen, who was a great devotee who would always organize these yatras for Lord Chaitanya. So because Lord Shivanand Sen was a close associate of the Lord, and he was attached to giving mercy to the dog immediately in that lifetime only went straight back to Golok Vrindavan, just because it was attached to Shivanand Sen. And Shivanand Sen was attached to giving the mercy to the Lord. So this is bhakti. So then Maharaj also continued, he said that Raghunandas Goswami asked Chaitanya Mahaprabhu that, okay, I have now, what are the duties of a person who is detached? And then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gave a very simple process which is important for us all. So some basic things. So this is the Lord Krishna himself directly telling through Raghunandas Goswami to all of us. Don't speak gossip and don't listen to gossip. So now we come down to brass tacks. You know, we may be reading Bhagavatam every day, or we may be chanting every day. We should do that. I mean, we come to the temple every day. But it doesn't mean that we miss out on these critical aspects, because these are natural behavioral. I won't say natural, but it is understandable that this happens our mind gets distracted, and therefore through that we find less problematic for us if we are to it's like an escapism. Then when we see other people's problems or what is happening elsewhere, perhaps we get a little relief, a little curiosity, and then that becomes a source of maybe joy or happiness. So it's very dangerous. So don't speak gossip. Gossip means anything which is immaterial, unconnected to Krishna, or even if it is, it may be in your occupation activity, you can do the needful. But if you were to stray into things which are not relevant, and especially if it is detrimental about someone else's situation, then say negative things, then you become addicted. He said, because we have nothing else to do, and becomes very polluting. And Rup Goswami says that prajalpa steals away our bhakti. So one is that keep away from gossip, not to speak and not to listen also. Second is just dress yourself simply, and therefore dress the deities very beautifully. This is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu telling Raghunandas Goswami. And I can say that, one of the things which I think many of us would see, that when we came to the temple, something which was very attractive was we see the ashram devotees, basically there's only one color, or two colors maybe, white and saffron. But the cleanliness of a temple and was not only external, but then the whole atmosphere internally also, because of the deities, because of the holiness of the place, the scriptures reading every day, devotees come here for service. So it completely transforms. So it becomes even though very simple clothes, but when we come to the deities and we see something, how many people, millions come all over the world every day, because they're mesmerized by the beauty of the Lord. And that's because sincere devotees are putting all their efforts to dress the deities. So that's very important, that dress the deities very beautiful, but dress yourself simply. And unfortunately today, anybody even makes this statement that dress simply, especially in the context of ladies, you have committed 10 murders, because people are completely flabbergasted. Now, how can you even say it? My freedom is affected. How can you say this? So, Prabhupada said that when we dress Krishna's, when we see Krishna dressed so beautifully with jewels, we lose the desire to decorate ourselves. That's a very important point. And we must, one thing I would like to point out, then Prabhupada wrote this purport, which we talk of, which is an incredible purport encapsulating everything. He wrote this even before he went to the US, because this is the first canto. So he wrote it in 1950s, late 50s, early 60s. So we're talking of 60 years ago. He has not even gone to the US, because going to the US and seeing success, that's not, he had nothing. So he is saying this in his consciousness, which has been immaterial, whether he's in Los Angeles or whether he's in Vrindavan, is just between him and Krishna, and how he's seeing it. And any simple-minded person also can easily see that how somebody speaks 60 years ago, such deep philosophy, such deep penetrating points about how the Krishna conscious lifestyle can be from using occupation. 60 years ago, so how even more relevant today. So, dressing the deities beautifully, eating simply, and seeing that Krishna is eating beautiful prasad, offering all respect to others and not demanding or expecting any respect to yourself. So this, Radhana Swami Maharaj said that this is real detachment. That means real detachment is not only giving up things. It is even giving respect to when we don't feel like. I mean, because we may see it different way, but when we see it from the eyes of Krishna, or when we see it from the eyes of a guru or from senior devotees, then our perspective of someone, because we may get irritated by someone's habit, or we maybe get somebody, everyone has weaknesses, but then we focus on that, and then we tend to be disrespectful in our mind at least. And then when we see from Krishna's point of view, or Guru's point of view, that how he appreciates, there must be something, and then immediately, without fail, we will see that that is an objective view, that is a overview, which is a balanced perspective of a person, seeing that this person is attached to Prabhupada, the deities, etc. And then there may be irritants also, but we never calculate how much we must be irritants to others, or we must be causing resentment to others. And then I'd like to end by what Radha Gopinath Prabhu once in his class, and he was speaking about this during the incident which is described between Devyani and Sharmishta. Devyani was a daughter of Shukracharya, and Sharmishta was the daughter of a king. And then they had a very small issue which became a big thing. Basically, just a matter of they were all having a bath, and then one comes out and takes someone else's clothes by mistake. And then the kind of words that were used, it is so parallel to what we go through. One calling the other a dog, and the other calling all kinds of names. It just escalated. So how ego can escalate smallest thing to a large thing, and this is practically every day. We see it everywhere around us, how a small thing can really become so big, and then we have to take positions, then we have to defend our situation, and then it affects us. Sometimes we justify and we rationalize it, and then sometimes we are very guilty about it. It completely, and then if you don't realize that, okay, I should not repeat it and come down hard, then this again happens, because it can happen regularly with everybody. So he made the point that, just by one word which is spoken, he gave the example of how when we take tests, blood test or urine test or stool test, so the output is measured. So everything that output will give, when they take the test, and they will then see what is the condition of the body, what are the diseases, which problem is there. So that means just one little output and they get an analysis of your body. So similarly, how we behave or how we speak is a barometer for really what is our lineage, what is our conditioning, what is our background, what is our parentage, everything. So we have to be very careful in how we behave. And he mentioned that in that context, that Bhagavad Gita 16.4 really gives the ego test, just like the blood test. And the ego test is because it says that the different symptoms like pride, arrogance, conceit, harshness, anger and ignorance, these are the qualities that belong to those with demoniac nature. So this is the translation of 16.4. So the point he makes is that when we hear demoniac, the word demoniac, it's a relief to know that, well, it is not for me, it is for someone else, you know, demoniac. But he said actually demoniac, what is defined as demoniac is, it means a person influenced by the modes of passion and ignorance. It doesn't mean that you have, you know, fangs or two heads or ugly face and some mystic rakshas powers. No, you may be normal, but you are demoniac if you are influenced by the modes of passion and ignorance. So now we have to ask, how many of us is not influenced by this? Then we find that, well, I could be demoniac or I may be demoniac at times. So he said that then he was reading the purport. So in the purport, Prabhupada starts by saying, this verse describes the royal road to hell. The royal road to hell, because of all these, you know, conceit and harshness of word, etc. One thing leads to another. You know, when you have pride and then your hypocrisy, because of that you are expecting a lot of people to see the way you are and you don't see it that way. Because ultimately, ego means that you want people to be looking at the way you want it. If they see it in a different way, you are upset. When you get upset, you get angry. When you get angry, then you speak harsh words. That's the cycle that goes. And that's the harsh word is the output, which is really reflecting our state of mind and consciousness internally. So he said that in this verse, you can just substitute the word saying that the demoniac person, he said, instead of that, put your name. So, you know, Dash Das wants to make a show of advancement. This is the purport, but this is a demoniac person wants to make a show of advancement of spiritual science. So he's saying Dash Das wants to make a show of advancement of spiritual science, although he does not follow the principles. Now, this is very generic and applicable. You know, it could be to us sometimes, many times, often, that we may be oftentimes getting into the mode. Now we know how to behave, how to talk, what we have to show as a spiritual manifestation, you know, we choose the right word, right dress, right behavior. So we have to constantly examine as to what is my intent and whether I am just, you know, I'm being hypocrite or whether I'm struggling to do what is needed to do. So therefore, a spiritualist also may become a demoniac person in the sense that by trying to imitate someone, because we want to be what the other person is. So we may say externally, like, you know, every child wants to be a cricketer like so and so, he wants to be rich like so and so. That is in the material world. But so we may think, okay, but we also may be thinking that I also would like to show my knowledge, I also want to show my attributes, spiritual attributes, I want to, in a world of devotees, I am also someone. So it is equally applicable as this demoniac nature could be if you get influenced by the modes of passion and ignorance. So just to sum up, while, you know, all of us have to make a sense of where we are, what we are born in, our circumstances, anywhere, any part of the world, we have our occupation duty, whether at home, outside, whichever state of life, whatever gender, education, etc. We do the best, but we see our material life through the prism of the spiritual lives. And the spiritual eyes we may not have the wisdom, but then we attach ourselves to Vaishnavas, to devotees, to those who are more serious. It's like in school, when if you are in the circle of devotees, people who are more studious, then you tend to start also studying more. And if you are going to be with loafers or people, the backbenchers, you know, the LLBs, you know, lords of the last bench, then you're also going to be in the same way. So therefore, here also we have a choice. So if we see through the eyes of them, and then our faith in Vaishnavas, faith in devotees, faith in the deities, and then faith in our Guru becomes more. And slowly we'll move from darkness to light, and then from hope to despair. Hare Krishna. Sorry, we've gone over today. Thank you. There's no time for questions, I'm sorry.